Welcome back to the Daily Stack. I'm in the studio, but I did not record this one in video because I hadn't quite set up the video setup while I was on the road this last time. But I'm really excited to bring you this episode with Evan Stapler. He's one of the competitors that has been one of the breakout competitors of the PGF. So if you haven't noticed the pattern, I grabbed a couple of those guys as I've been around in their world. And tried to get some interviews in. So Evan and I stayed late after practice one night and sat down and recorded, and I kind of got some of his thoughts on Jiu Jitsu and training with Brandon up there in Decatur and kind of the PGF and everything that he's been doing. So I hope everybody enjoys this episode. I really enjoyed recording it. I hope everybody enjoys the podcast as it's been coming out, because I'm, you know, really starting to try to keep up with my content, because I've got a lot of content going out there. But, you know, because usually I'm dropping some sort of an ad for my advertising company here. But right now I'm pretty busy. But if you have anything that you would like to start as a project for video work or podcasting, you can hit us up over there at Turnkey Connections or Blind Lincoln Productions. And here in this studio at Parkway Automotives is the Peach Podcast Syndicate. You can find it at the Peach Podcast Syndicate on Instagram and on Facebook. And it'll eventually have a YouTube channel coming. But in the meantime, if you are interested in the Middle Georgia area in starting a podcast, you can contact me either at Turnkey Connections, Blind Lincoln Productions, my own personal account over at, or you can also contact Peach Podcast Syndicate directly to start scheduling some possibilities for yourself on producing something in this wonderful studio that Brandon Veal has so graciously built. And we have started a lot of projects out of here. The Dream Show, the Knife Fella. I can look at that. But anyways, we've got a couple shows that we're putting out here and a couple shows we're putting together for the future. So if you have any interest in podcasting or starting a podcast or doing anything of that nature, Peach Podcast Syndicate might have some solutions for you. So without any further ado, go over and listen to me and Evan chop it up about the PGF. So without any further ado, Mr. Evan Stapler. And we're live on the Daily Stack with Evan Stapler. Now, just imagine, because I don't have my whole setup here. Imagine that your song's playing in the background. And if people are true fans of the Daily Stack, they've been following my most recent project over there with Stephen Eakins on the Dream Show. And you are the theme song for the show right now, because Stephen digs it. So, how many times did you win? Evan, welcome to the Daily Stack.
Thank you. How many times did you win? Thank you for having me.
Cool, bro.
It feels great to be here.
Bro, I have enjoyed it. I've enjoyed chatting with you before the show. And so what started you we're talking about your song, we're talking about the show, but like, we're over here at the PGF and you jumped in to some deep waters. You're a blue belt, correct?
Yes, sir.
So, did Brandon approach you, or did you hear about this competition and just decide, "Yo, I'm in"?
How did that play out?
He told me about it and asked me what my weight was before the first PGF. And I was walking around at like maybe 215, 210, and it was 195, you know? And I had never cut weight for a tournament before.
Right.
And I was going to have to do it every week for 8 weeks. So he was just like, I wouldn't like worry about it.
No. Yeah. That's a new experience. The cutting weight experience is something that like most normal people can't really wrap their brain around. But so you started jiu-jitsu. How long have you been training now?
Just over 2 years as of right now.
Yeah. 2 years.
Started December of 2018.
What got you started?
It was just after I had got on this little kick about just losing weight and not being, you know, real fat and lazy anymore.
What'd you weigh?
I was 303 pounds. That was nice. My heaviest. Yeah.
Had you ever done anything athletic before?
I had played football once in fourth grade, ninth grade, and I wrestled for like 2.5 years in middle school.
Okay.
Yeah. So a little bit.
A little bit. So like you got enough. Did you get good at the wrestling?
Not really. Okay. I didn't really get good because
Was it what held you back at that point?
Really myself.
Yeah.
Honestly myself and just kind of the environment. I just didn't really like the environment.
Yeah.
It provided.
Too hostile, okay. So that's, and you were saying earlier you were from up here, so that was here around here.
Yeah. That was just at East Limestone for a few years.
So. Okay, cool. So you come in and you're 303 pounds. What was your first experience with jiu-jitsu?
I remember my first night. So it was just after that, you know, like kick I had been on about just losing weight, you know, being more healthy. So I probably lost maybe like 30 pounds.
Okay.
So
did you do that through diet?
No, just working out.
Just working out.
Yeah,
okay.
I didn't really change what I eat much.
Okay.
Like this week is the only time I've been really strict with a diet because I have to cut weight for that grappling games on March 13th.
Yeah.
So yeah. But before that, I didn't really watch what I ate that much. I just worked.
Wait. So you went from 303 pounds down to like 210 just off your work.
To about 270.
Okay.
Just off of like working out. And then when I started jiu-jitsu, it just dropped like rapidly.
Right.
Because
I
was still working out and running a lot too.
How much do you run?
Well, not as much now, but when I first started out, I was running like 5 miles. I would do that maybe 2 to 3 times a week at the most, 5 mile runs.
That's nothing to shake a stick at.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was there a pivotal moment that just made you, or did you just look at yourself one day and just like, man, I'm done. I'm not going to do this anymore.
Yeah. I can't honestly, I can't really pinpoint the exact moment. I do just remember like, obviously, you know, seeing 303 pounds on the scale, but, I'm pretty sure I just like that day I was like, I just started running.
Yeah.
I can't remember like when really it was, but like, I just remember I was like, okay, I have to do something.
Did you look up like, cause I recently like in which 2019, I was going to, I had made it to a goal to go to Worlds, which means that I wanted to walk around at like 175. And for me to like walk at that, like I got to do a lot of road work. And so I had to like, I went through like 2 or 3 times where like I injured myself, you know, running before I like looked up how to run. Did you like figure out how to run or did you just like trudge through it?
Yeah, I just took off. Like I would just, I would just take off.
Yeah. So the first experience with jiu-jitsu. So you've done this, you've lost the weight. You're down to like 270, mm-hmm. Whatever. Yep. You start jiu-jitsu. So what was that first day of jiu-jitsu like?
After 2 shrimps down the mat, I was like, fuck, dude, my shirt was like covered in sweat. I had felt soreness in places in my knees. I'd never felt soreness before.
Right.
All we were doing was a double underpass. And I could not do it, like, for the life of me. I couldn't get it down the whole time. And it was Seth and Jason I was working with, those two guys. So, like, they were just so helpful and just, like, actually cared about it and really wanted to help me through it. And, like, I hadn't really experienced that.
Watch, smack your hand because I can hear it. Oh, you're good. No, you're good. The people. You just don't want to knock the people. You're good. Yeah. You're good. Somebody's driving down the road right now. And they're like, oh, what was that? I just hit a child. No. Guys, yeah. Man. So when you're going through all that and you're, I had a little bit of concept of grappling and whatnot, because I had a buddy that was a wrestler when I was in college who had taken me to a couple wrestling practices. And so like I had like understood grappling a little bit. Did you have the concept from wrestling? Did it transfer right in? Because like I've now rolled with you. I think I rolled with you at the PJF, but now I've rolled with you a couple times here. And like, one, you're definitely the solid blue belt. I've definitely, you know, the people are going to have to watch the PGF to see your performance. But I mean, like, you jumped into this. Did you have that confidence and bravado about you from the get-go?
Just like with from jiu-jitsu or from like wrestling?
From jiu-jitsu, like when you came into jiu-jitsu, like, did you have the way, like, I'm trying to put it without, you know, revealing anything, but like rolling with you personally. I feel that it's like, oh no, this dude's gonna make me kill him. And not really in a vicious way, like you're not really malicious in the way that you're doing it, but it's like, no, like I'm gonna actually have to finish whatever it is that I'm doing. I'm not gonna get some half-ass like tap because like you're quote unquote tired. Was that just like day one?
No, you're kind of
a pushover in the beginning.
I was tapping early in places and just like, yeah. Somebody would just, you know, go like this. I'm like, okay. And I feel that with some guys, and I'm just like, dude, come on,
don't tap.
You know, now. Yeah. But that was me first starting off. I'm like, right. You know, somebody's got their shit around my neck.
They just got it wrapped around your neck, and then you just like all they have is like a more like the schoolyard choke or something like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, like some places, I'm literally like wheezing. I'm just like, I can still breathe if I'm wheezing, I guess. Like, I don't know. You know, sometimes I find myself just like, somebody's really trying to finish arm triangle, and I'm literally just trying to find like pockets of air, you know, like,
right.
Yeah. So,
yeah, no, so like, what, how did you develop that? Was that, I mean, like, where did you just like find that within yourself? I'm like, I'm a warrior, bro. Like, I'm gonna fight. Like, where did you find that?
I guess it just came from training and realizing like, I just want to get better. And I just have to, I don't know. Sorry.
No, you're good. It's a conversation, bro.
It's just a lot more fun that way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the, like, it's a play thing. Yeah. Like, you're able to come in and you go, like, you're coming in, you're playing the game of, like, I'm not going to die. And, like, you've proven to yourself over and over, you're like, oh, well, that was scary, but I'm not dead.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, so, like, is that kind of what attracts you back every time?
I was thinking about this earlier today. I just really like facing the adversity of it.
Mm.
You know, just, like, I don't know if this is cool to give away, I guess, but that thing Stephen was talking about, he posted on his Facebook, like, the tournament.
The tournament that we're putting on?
Yeah, yeah.
You're talking about the Mid-South Classic.
Okay.
You gonna be in it?
I'm pretty sure I am.
Was that the you talking about the conversation y'all had on your wall?
Yeah, the one in April.
Yeah. Dope. That'll be cool. That'll be fun. Yeah. That'll be fun. Heck yeah, man.
So what are like the rules of that? Like what's that?
EBI. So I'm sorry, Steven, Brandon, if any of y'all are even listening, you know. If I mutilate it, the EBI rules were the Eddie Bravo Invitational, and it's basically the one that we're doing. I think we're doing, crap, I don't remember. They were either, no, the PGF were 6-minute rounds, right?
Yeah.
So we were doing 10-minute rounds. It's a 10-minute round, and then if there's no, it's sub only, and if there's no submission, you go to the difference in EBI rule set is the EBI overtime, which is where you start off. I don't know if y'all do that here.
Spider web and back.
You just go to that interchange and that's the overtime, and then that's the winner. It's the, this time go around, we're doing the 225 and 170 guys, and it'll be it's $100 buy-in, $800 guarantee, but like every time we've done it, like sponsors and people have jumped in and been like, yo, like if you get a twister, you get like $250 in a burrito or like stuff like that. So like we've had, I know Zach Edwards out there and Sam Barbosa have both competed, and like a couple of the big names that have competed on it, and it's pretty cool. It's live streamed. It'll be on.
Is Facebook. It just like a 1 day thing?
Yeah. It's a one day, four matches. What is that, right? Three matches, whatever an 8-man bracket breaks down to. Okay, cool. Yeah. It's been fun. Like that's been my first experience with like being on the production side of things, of a competition. Like I've competed a lot and I've done a lot of, you know, MMA fights and stuff like that. But being on the production side, like especially like on the PGF stuff and all that, has been really fun. Like to see that like play out, because like you were just in on a conversation, like listening to me and Keelan talk about like cultural stuff that's going on for the like the culture of jiu-jitsu in the South is kind of like growing in a really kind of cool way, and it's exciting.
Yeah,
I think it's pretty cool. Like that's, if you had told me when I first got into jiu-jitsu that like the first time I was impressed, I went to a competition in Atlanta where it was a auditorium that was like literally floor to ceiling people. Like there were people sitting on the floor, and then behind them there were people sitting in chairs all the way up to the back of the like it was like a pitched type seating. And so there was just nothing but people. And I mean, I don't know how many people there were in that room, but like a lot of people, and it was loud and rowdy for a jiu-jitsu match. Like all I'd ever experienced was like these lame like jiu-jitsu tournaments that like me and Brandon talked about this on the episode that he came on here of like, we're talking about like, don't invite your friends to jiu-jitsu tournaments. They'll hate you. Have you done any like local tournaments, quote unquote?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've done, my first one was 6 months after training.
Nice.
And that was at Triad of Madison, and I got first place in that one.
Nice. First one, yeah. Nice. What kind of rule set were they doing?
I believe so. It was Submission League.
Okay. I saw their stuff. Okay. Yeah. That's dope. That's crazy. That's, my little sister started training right at 2 years. So like right about the same thing. And she did 26 days after she started, she competed. And it was in like one of those good fight sub onlys. I called her back. I was like, you know, this is sub only, right? She was like, yeah. I was like, oh, all right. So what'd you think? Did that competition, how did that feel? Had you ever won like when you played football and stuff? Like, had you ever like scored a touchdown?
No. I was always playing offensive or defensive line.
Okay.
And I didn't get like that much play time.
Yeah. So what did being the center of attention feel like?
Shoot. Sorry, the memory lapse.
You're good. Yeah, you're good.
What were you saying before that? I'm like kind of.
Oh, the competition.
So oh shoot!
The submission first, league. Your first, yeah, competition. Back submission on track. League.
Yeah. So the first match, I literally got in there and just scrambled around with a dude for like a minute and a half, maybe. Then I got into side control and he just tapped out. That was the first match.
You just tapped him from just exhaustion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just got in there, just cross facing really hard, and then yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah, I just tapped out.
So how many matches were there? Was it just that one?
I had three.
You had three?
And then the second time, this like really buff dude that I was thinking like, oh shit, he might actually beat me. He gets around on my back. And he picks me up and just like slams me.
Yeah.
And then like I got a DQ win off of that. And I was like, okay,
cool.
I was like, thankfully, like he didn't actually kill me. So
yeah.
And then the last match, there was this one dude. He's like a local dude. I think it's Tyler or something. I don't know. But like after the tournament, everybody was like, I did not expect for you to beat him.
Yeah.
Because there was a guy that has been training here at the same time that was a lot better than me at the time, named Gavin, Bruce's son, and he beat that guy that I beat in the final. So that was kind of like, oh shit.
Oh wow. Yeah. That's cool. Yeah. So you win your first tournament and you win this competition, and now you're like hooked, right?
Yeah.
Like this is now I'm Evan. I'm a jiu-jitsu fighter, right? That's how you feel.
Yeah.
That's dope. So like as that develops and like I've come in and started hanging out with Brandon and training with Brandon and kind of like hearing the thing, what's it like being direct? Like that's your only view of jiu-jitsu, right? Like you didn't train anywhere else or anything like that. No. So like he is your sensei. He is your like whatever you want to call like, like what is that day to day like? Or do you even like, does that even register for y'all?
The day to day, I mean, like you're talking about just from like training,
like just training, just being around him. Like, I guess you don't even really, as I say that, you don't even really have a measuring stick as to what I'm talking about. As far as like, have you trained at other schools now that you've been training for a couple years?
I've just visited locally. Like, I went to Maverick for like a class, just a Muay Thai class,
right?
And because I was interested, and then I went to Coleman.
Right.
No, not Coleman. I'm sorry. Triad of Madison. That's what it was. Triad of Madison and just like an MMA class there.
Okay. So like all your jiu-jitsu is Brandon.
Yeah. Every single bit of it. Yeah.
That's fascinating. And that's the Brandon and I talked about the fact that like here, everybody rolls different. Nobody rolls the same, which like that's pretty rare. Like you go to other schools, most of the time you're like, oh, like I can tell who all y'all train with because y'all all roll like him, or you roll like, or you can, and it's usually like the best guy in the gym, or the black belt, you know, which however that shakes out, and you can go, oh, well, like they all do the exact same thing like you do, and like I can see little taste of things that Brandon does in all of you when I roll with you. But like, you're all unique, and that's like from your perspective. How do you think that's play? How do you think that happens?
I just really love training.
Yeah,
that's all it comes down to. I get a lot of drilling in, and I just like learning new stuff and just making it work.
Yeah,
like I'd like the last tournament. I feel like I could have performed better. And I've just been working on that. I really want to just get in there and just start winning those initial exchanges, just getting after it. I'm not saying that's going to help me win, but, like, it just feels a lot better just getting in there and getting my game going first and just not wasting any time.
What would you – because, I mean, you're a blue belt, so everything's evolving. I mean, like, we talked about it in class tonight at some point that he was saying that, like, you know, you're probably at that, like, collection of moves point. Like where are you in that adventure?
It like really it's all about just getting better, like on a day to day thing.
Like what's your game?
I just like to get on top, honestly, as much as I can and stay on top.
Yeah.
I just really don't like for you to be like resting and like trying to recover and like just chilling. Like I always like trying to advance and improve my position.
Yeah.
You know, there is some spots where obviously I'm getting smashed and people like, you know,
right.
I get a taste of my own medicine, but for the most part, I'm trying to be just the hammer, not the nail.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So and, like you try to actively reach out and be the hammer.
Yeah.
Yeah. How does that play out for you most of the time?
Well, first that's just mostly from like a competition.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
I don't have to be like, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. Like, yeah. In the training room. Especially if people want to go back and listen to the episode that I did with Brandon, like you can hear the philosophy that he like preaches, and that's 100% like what you kind of feel when you roll with the guys here. Like everybody, like I said, like you have variations of like you get, you know, you're hard to finish, but you're not like in a brutish way, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So like. But, like, do you have a game plan that you play? Or do you just kind of, you're not flaily. Like, you don't go out and flail. But, like, how do you accomplish getting to top? Or do you even know?
Sometimes, honestly, it just kind of happens. Like, you know, in scrambles and stuff. And I'm just there. I don't get it off like like every scramble, but probably like maybe 30 to 40% of scrambles I could probably get out on top, I'd
yeah.
say.
Yeah.
A lot of it comes from like recently I've just been working on a lot more stand up and yeah. just takedowns. And that's what I want to get in there in competition and start working, you know.
Start trying to feel yeah, what just, it feels like to do a takedown at full speed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. yeah. So what most people come in and they start doing jiu-jitsu and they start like competing and they get a little taste and they kind of have fun. What makes you go from doing this submission thing that's like in like kind of a local school to jumping into something like PGF or, you know, like, I mean, you're diving headfirst into some waters that, like, I know guys that are brown belts that would look at that list and be like, "Yeah, I'm good." Like, what makes you want to jump in those waters?
Like, I said earlier, I think it's just really facing that adversity. Like, that's what I was thinking about earlier. Just today, I was like, you know, when those guys were getting in on chat, like Elijah, and like I saw Eric Anders jump in there. It's looking mm-hmm. like he was interested. I was like, holy shit. Like, I would get another shot at Elijah. You know, like, I would totally go for that. Like, uh-huh. for real. You know.
Oh, you're talking about over at the Mid-South.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. yeah okay. Yeah. Okay. So yeah. you're about that life. You're yeah. about just, you just want to feel what the top tier feels. Hey, man, that's respect. I mean, I remember when you dropped your music video that we were talking about at the beginning of this episode, that like the biggest thing that Stephen kept harping on, he's like, bro, like that dude just went out there and put himself out there, and he's like you're not gonna hurt that dude in some like competition. Like, this is here's a really good example. We were sitting out there earlier and we were talking about stand-up, which I got a buddy that I filmed a special with that like I saw it firsthand. Like, that stuff's terrifying. Like, on stage is terrifying. So have you been just writing raps just in your back room all this time and like nobody knew about it? Or do you have like this album out there? Are you like a closet like superstar? Like,
yeah, it's really just like garage. Like, I could record in my garage.
Yeah.
On Apple headphones.
There you go.
All through my iPad. Some of the beats I make just on like a synthesizer
right.
in my room, I'll use GarageBand, so I'll just run it through that and then can play melodies.
How long have you been doing music?
I started when I was 15, just using like some Apple software and stuff like GarageBand.
Like GarageBand, yeah.
Yeah, but I was just really interested in it. I just really, I've like always loved music since I was like a little kid. I remember having like a SpongeBob CD player and like hearing the song Grills by Nelly for the first time was like the shit. I was just like, it's the best. And then right. hearing like Eminem, you know, the real Slim Shady, just, and not just rap, like any kind of music, like all
really?
Kinds of music, yeah.
Do you play any instruments or anything?
Just piano, really. That's kind okay. of the only one. I'll mess around on guitar, but I don't really know how to play.
Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. yeah. I'm the same way. Like, I took enough. I can read music, and I took enough guitar lessons when I was young to like, I can play a G chord, hardcore G chord.
I cannot even do
that's
that.
That's about it. So like, all right, rap is your thing too. Like, I mean, what's your influence? Because like what you put out, for those who don't know, is a lot,
mm-hmm.
and you put it out. And did you have that in your back pocket already, or did you just like, I mean, there's very pointed stuff to the PGF. So did you come up with that just like off the cuff of like, it's gonna be my promo piece?
Yeah, I did. Yeah,
I remember like I came in here and you were like talking to me about my camera stuff, and I was like, yeah. And we were like, we're talking about cameras, and you're like, yeah, I shot a music video, and I was like, oh, cool, whatever. And then I saw it later, and I was like, oh, dude, like he was serious, like that is crazy. So like, how did that play out? What possessed you to, because bro, I love you to death and I have been impressed with everything that you did, but like that took balls Like that, like you're jumping off in some deep water and then you drop a mixtape on top of these dudes' head. Like, what was going through your head?
I just like making music. That's really all it was. Yeah. I was like, he started talking about promos and I kept seeing dudes. Like, there was just one dude that made a promo for it and then didn't even go through with it. And he was just literally just sweaty and his fucking clock was beeping. He was like, y'all better be ready. Y'all better be hungry and shit. And I was just like, what the fuck was that? I was like, that was horrendous.
I didn't even see it. I was like, that's a promo? Is this on the internet?
It was a while back. It was before, like, you know, like, there was a few guys that had dropped out.
Oh, okay.
They might have had, like, maybe 24 at the time.
Right.
And the guys just kept dropping out. So he was one of those guys.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I was just like, dude, fuck all this. I was like.
So you just like, I'm gonna drop the mixtape of the year. I got you.
Yeah.
So, like, I mean, your process as far as, like, your music writing. Take me through it a little bit. Like, do you sit down with a sketch pad and you're just like, are you, like, Slim Shady in it in the closet? Like, what are you doing?
So just, like, the inspiration as a whole?
Yeah, like, how do you build a song?
Well, I started with, so it's based off, you know, the 21 Savage and J. Cole song?
Okay.
A lot. So that's what it, like, I remade that beat.
Right.
I remade that, and then I just rapped on it. That's really all I did.
I mean, you say that like I couldn't just sit here and just bust out a rap. Like, you laid down. Let's see. I'm trying to think on the specifics because, I mean, it was down to, like, who directed that video? Was that all out of your mind too? Like, that was all you.
I took me and my friend Sawyer. He trains here to a track around Athens Middle School that I used to run the 5 miles around.
Yeah.
I like that place.
I mean, like, you're in a creek.
Yeah.
Why, were you just like, I'm going to go over here, film me in this creek? Like, is that exactly how that played? That is great.
Exactly how it goes,
That is great.
Yeah, I just took him out there and I was like, all right, dude, just do this. Get right here. All right, center it up. All right, no, angle off right here. Yeah, I'm just going to stand on this rock in the creek.
Yeah. That was great. So that Naga belt, was that your Naga belt?
Yeah, it was mine. I won that on October 30th, on Halloween, actually, last year.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. So that was, I mean, so like you've just been collecting souls.
That's what it feels like.
Yeah.
I like using that term.
Yeah.
Since the first competition, first match, like, I was like, okay. I was like, can you even do that? Is that you can just tap to side control?
Yeah.
Like,
I can make you miserable enough to where you can just tell me that you've had enough. Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
I didn't even think I was doing much, really. But yeah.
See, there's your answer for the next time people ask you why you do this, is that, like, I like to just absorb their soul and just eat them, you know, and become more powerful each time.
I feel like one of those Death Eaters off of Harry Potter, you know, where they're like sucking the souls through. That's what that feels like.
That's the superpower you would opt for.
Oh yeah, for sure.
That'd be dope. That would be dope. Like, especially from a jiu-jitsu standpoint, pull them down into like a rubber guard. I have now fallen off into that world and just followed Brandon off into the. It's pretty cool.
Yeah,
it's really cool.
I'm
drinking the Kool-Aid, man.
Yeah.
Like, I've enjoyed that whole realm of possibilities with the upper body and tying it up and not getting punched, because I'm a big fan of being able to control scenarios and situations like that. But the music. So are you trying to be a rap star? What are you trying to do with your life? Are you just out here training and enjoying your thing?
Yeah, that's really all it's about. I'm just
What do you do for a living?
So it's mostly just jiu-jitsu, and I do DoorDash.
Okay.
So I just deliver food.
So you're just living the jiu-jitsu life.
Yeah.
Bro, man, some people would be jealous. A lot of people would be jealous, because that's like kind of what I'm asking you. Like, a lot of this is interesting to see you from see it from the eyes of like, this is all you know about the jiu-jitsu world, and kind of, you know, building to the confidence to be able to, like, coming back to that original question of like building to the confidence of being able to jump off into something that, like, you see names like Eric Anders and you're like, I don't want that smoke. All right, bro.
Yeah, like, it's just, you know, those big names pop up and I'm like, oh shit. Like,
just to be able to feel it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because that's why you train. Yeah. I get it. Yeah. I get it. That's like, all right, you may not even be familiar with this in some schools, that it's kind of frowned upon to, like, call out, like, higher belts in some schools. Like, they'll, I mean, you'll just get smashed for asking, like, a black belt, especially for asking a black belt to roll. But, like, I've always had that same mentality of, like, people would look at me when I would be somewhere, like, I rolled with Jacal one time because I went to ATT Atlanta and people had told me that, like, they're like, ah, there's no reason to swing through there. He's never there. And I, like, show up, like, randomly on a Thursday at, like, noon, and sure enough, he's there. And then, like, everybody's partnered off, and I'm like, you want to roll? He's like, sure. And I was like, cool. I got smashed. Had fun. Yeah. And I learned a couple things. Like, that's, I get it. I get it. And so, like, it's interesting to watch somebody experience that and, like, jump off in the competition side of it and just plug your nose and go. Props to you, bro. Props to you. So, anyways, the music. Do you have other music out there? Do you have other things on SoundCloud?
I really just started making beats, so I have just made a lot of beats in, like, you know, since I was 15. So when I first started, you know, they were just basic samples.
How many would you ask? Are they on a website somewhere?
No, like, no? A lot of them are just, like, kind of lost in software. Like, I don't keep a lot of them.
Yeah.
You know, but like in total, just in beats, I'd probably say like a couple hundred, nothing hundred, crazy. I'm nothing, not into the wild. Thousands, I wouldn't say, but yeah.
Do you do mostly like me, I'm a big fan of, like, what would you say you're a fan of when it comes to beats? Like, are you a fan of the producer's beats, like the producer's stuff? Are you a fan of, like, what are you a fan of when it comes to that?
Like, a little bit of both. I like it from the producer and the rapper aspect a lot. So, you know, if a song's got a good beat and, like, a good lyricist on it, you know, for example, like, a lot of Eminem songs are that way. They got a really good beat and Eminem's on it. It's like, oh, shit.
Are you familiar with how the music industry works in that regard?
Not much.
It's really interesting when you get into, like, how they, like, get people to come in. And I was reading an article about Logic and kind of, like, how he does it. And it's pretty interesting on the pulling in the people that are, like, I cannot remember the name of the song, but it was an Outkast song that he, like, references recently. And it was, like, super cool to, like, go back and, like, figure out the lineage of the song and the, like, where he found it and, like, his reference and that type thing. Like, are you into, like, are you a hip hop head, quote unquote?
No, I'm not just a hip hop head.
No,
I like all kinds of music, dude. On the way to training this morning, I was listening to who is it? Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons. That song "Walk Like a Man," "Can't Take My Eyes Off You."
I don't know.
Those are two bangers right there. You'd probably hear one of them if you knew them. But yeah.
Okay. Wait, are you talking about, like, it's like Frank Sinatra type music?
Yeah, like, in a way.
Like,
it's
like
just like four or five dudes though, but, like, yeah, and they're all, like, singing and shit.
Okay. I feel it. I feel it. That's dope.
Yeah.
That's dope.
And I really like taking music like that and music that is even older, you know, say like maybe 1930s,
okay,
40s, 50s and all that, and then like sampling that into something like that song, the A Lot one, that it's actually a sample from another song, I Love You by East of Underground.
Mm-hmm.
And that was like a group of...
They
like,
hit us for monetization on Steven's channel.
They did?
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Damn.
I don't care.
Damn, okay. Is that... Yeah.
We're not even getting anything anyways.
Okay,
cool. Yeah. No, I'm not worried about it.
All right.
I'd rather just use your song.
Mm-hmm.
It makes it cooler.
Yeah.
Screw YouTube.
Yeah.
Give those people their money.
So it just goes good with the grappling, the Jiu Jitsu and stuff.
I dig it. I think it's flows. It's so like we won't dig into the lyrics. The people can go listen to the song if they want to hear it. But like what did you write those lyrics in the attitude that they were written? Were you trying to write it to hype yourself up? Were you trying to like talk yourself? It sounded like you were just hyping yourself up and just being like, I know what it is gonna be. Yeah. It's gonna be what it is.
Yeah. I just said like it says in the song, I know you want people to go listen to it, but like I know I'm not the best.
Right.
So I just but like I'm not gonna let that stop me from giving it my best. That's what I especially learned coming up like during the PGF and coming out of it, like,
yeah,
it's okay if somebody's, you know, they're better than you, you know, Jake Elkins, Matt Elkins, both of those guys going in. I don't think I've had a single good role with either of them. You know what I'm saying? They have always just gave me the fucking work every role. And I'm just like, damn, of course they're both in here. And of course, because they're great martial artists and wrestlers and everything. And, you know, they should deserve a spot in there.
Yeah.
But
what was your biggest takeaway from the whole experience in PGF? Like, what was your big, like, without revealing anything, without like saying anything that happened, but like, what was your takeaway?
I mean, honestly, that was pretty much what I said. Oh shoot, sorry. I won't give away too much.
Oh no, you're good.
Yeah, I mean, I did say that like on camera after
right,
after, like, you know, the PGF when it was almost over right there, like, you know, if you're going into something, you know, like, you can't, you know, there's going to be adversity, or you know, you're doubting yourself or whatever, just fuck it, like, you got to find some kind of hope or faith or something, whatever it takes, you just got to pull it out and just give it your best, because that's all you can do, really.
So if you're going in and you know you're not the best, and you know you're not like necessarily going to be number one, is your shot in the dark your motivate? What's your motivation? Does that make sense?
Yeah. My motivation is just to be like it's just to have fun and just be like, be happy with myself and understand, like, you know, it's not the end of the world when I go out there and, you know, get choked and, you know, just over a minute, you know, by Hunter. Because he's a fucking black man, he's a beast.
Does it make you feel any better that the back take that's on the like trailer that he does? He did that to me like 17, like, because he was on Saturday. Did you roll on Saturday when they did the like open mat training for all the guys?
Yeah.
Yeah, so like I didn't know any of you guys were gonna train, and I was like, oh boy, this is like my one opportunity this week I'm gonna get to train. So I was like, yay. So I like walk out of the mat, and like the first person sitting right in front of me is Zach Edwards, like sitting like crisscross applesauce with his hands on his chin, like just looking at me. I was like, are you calling me out? He's like, yeah, let's roll. I was like, really? I was like, you're competing? He's like, yeah, just cool. We roll. That was a work. Then I go. And there's like, it's just bam, bam, bam. And I think my fourth roll was Hunter. And he would do that, like, bait me to do that outside, like, single leg X. And he would bait me to do that. And then he would, one time he even complimented. He was like, man, that's a really good bite. And then just whoop, hit my back. Did that like 17 times in a round. It's terrible. So if it makes you feel any better, That's how my round went with him okay. when I rolled with him. So, like, yeah. Every bit of the hype he lives up to.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, that was a very inspirational match. I'll say that for real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Which is already out there, so you yeah. can tell
yeah.
people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Go watch the PGF.
Go watch it, bro.
Yes.
Go watch it, yeah.
Yes. So, what do you want to leave the people with? What do you want to put out there? Like, what is your goal here to do all these competitions? I know that you've got the personal thing, but we're just jumping you into the momentum and pulling you right along. Like, what kind of a message do you want to put out there?
Like, honestly, I've thought about this before. I think that, you know, later on down the road, I would like to be a black belt one day.
Yeah.
I think that's really cool. I think it'd be pretty cool to have my own school one day. To do that, you know, I have to teach, understand that, you know, but yeah.
Yeah, that's cool.
That'd be really cool. And, you know, once you have that kind of platform, I can, you know.
Yeah.
Just.
You're definitely, like, training at a place that you can kind of learn and see, like, a model of, like, how to do it and, like, how to do it right. Because, like, creating something like this doesn't just happen. So, like, you're definitely, like, getting to see, like, that growth happen. So, well, man. I was glad to have you on.
For sure, dude.
It is super late.
Yeah, it's pretty late.
Yeah.
I don't even know what time it is.
I think it's like...
Got to be midnight.
No, it's only 11 o'clock.
Oh, shit.
It's not the worst. No, it's not the worst. Not the worst. Not the worst.
Not at all.
But hey, your socials. Do you have any socials you want to do?
Socials like
what? Instagram. Oh, my bad.
Oh, shoot.
Yeah. Instagram, Facebook, anything you want to plug.
Yeah, just follow me on Instagram, Facebook. Should, you know, just look up Evan Stapler. Something's got to pop up. I don't know my real.
I'm Evan Stapler. Yo, what's your handle? Do you not know your handle on Instagram?
Got to check it. See, this is how serious I take that stuff, dude. I don't even know my Instagram or Facebook. I can't even tell you the name.
Oh, right? You are so ready to be famous, bro. You're so ready to be famous. Like, right. You're on a successful, I was about to call it a TV show. Does that show your age now when you're like, it's a television show?
Yeah.
We're not even on TV. It's on the internet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Shout out to Keelan because that stuff is looking amazing.
Yeah.
So, plug it. What is it?
Socials. Instagram at EC_Stapler and Facebook at... Oh.
It should be just Evan Stapler.
Yeah, it should just be Evan Stapler. And YouTube.
You have a YouTube page?
Yeah. That should just be Evan Stapler as well.
What's on your YouTube?
Two songs. A Lot, the video, and a song called Six Man, One Keg. That's a parody of another song called Six Man, One Casket by Craig Zinn. I just remade the beat to that and then, like, rapped like a fucking country idiot over it. Yeah. So
that sounds like I need to go check that out.
It's pretty funny. I like it.
That sounds so. Are you more of like an Eminem, or are you more of like a Lil Dicky?
Probably not. I'm not like
you're not either one of those. Oh, no, nice.
Yeah,
you're Evan Stapler.
Like, I do like both of those.
Yeah,
I love both of those rappers. I like a lot of rappers and musicians and a lot of different types of music.
So, if somebody was gonna go to your YouTube channel, what would you say that they're gonna experience?
I don't know. You're just gonna see
amazingness. Go check out Evan Stapler on YouTube and blow those videos up.
Oh yeah, dude.
I guarantee you, Steven has probably. If I will send Steven that link and he will give you 300 views on A Lot alone. Cool.
Oh yeah, dude.
For sure. Appreciate it.
All right.
Bet.
Oh yeah, dude. Hey, how many people you tap? A lot. 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 How many times you get tapped? A lot. How many times you get pinned? A lot. How many times did you win? A lot. How many times did you lose? A lot. How many times did you quit? A lot. How many hours you put on the mat that you know you would never get back? A lot. Killers make them killers. That's a 7 just for me. Time is running out. I guess I'll set up for the 3. Plotting on you pros. I got that warrior in me. Even back when I was up to 303, yeah.
Yeah, I know I ain't the best. Had to get that off my chest. David Hasselhoff, that Superman chest. Yeah, I know I ain't the best. I don't care about the rest. Come here to give it my best, and not all you competitors I will contest. Yeah.